Mr. Chair, since I'm sure our colleagues also have questions. Mr. Chair, we request our resource person, Colonel Garma, na basahin po yung number 8 sa kanyang pinirmahang affidavit na whose copy was distributed sa mga miyembro ng Quadcom.
Okay. Mr. Colonel Chair. Garma, babasahin mo ba yung kabuuan?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Yung kabuuan?
Yes po, Mr. Chair.
Medyo ilang pahina po yan?
Only 3 or 4, but I'll be quick, Mr. Chair.
Sige. Okay. I don't see any objections from any of the chairs of the committee, nor the members. Sige, please, pakibasa mo lang ang iyong sinumpaang salaysay.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. On September 12, 2024 and September 27, 2024, I was invited to serve as a resource speaker during the recent legislative inquiry conducted by the Joint Committee on Dangerous Drug Public Order and Safety, Human Rights and Public Accounts of the Honorable House of Representatives regarding the investigation into the war on drugs of the previous administration. During these hearings, I was asked several questions concerning my knowledge or involvement in the deaths of 3 Chinese inmates of the Davao Penal Colony and the death of General Wesley Barayuga, all focusing on the alleged extrajudicial killings of the aforementioned individuals. I was also questioned about my relationship with the former president, as well as my career as a police officer and my tenure as the general manager of the Philippine Charity Chief Stakes Office. Throughout the hearings, I answered questions from the committee based on my personal knowledge. However, I did so with great apprehension as I recognized that my statements on national television could significantly endanger my life, the safety of my family, and others very close to me. After considerable reflection, I am now executing this affidavit to provide a comprehensive information to the Quadcom regarding everything I personally know about the war on drugs during the former administration. On May 2026, I received a call from the President, Rodrigo Roa Duterte, at approximately 5 a.m., instructing me to meet him at his residence in Doña Luisa, Davao City. I was already acquainted with them. With the mayor having served as the station commander in one of the police stations in Davao City during his tenure. During our meeting, he requested that I will locate a PNP officer or operative who is a member of the Iglesia Ni Cristo, indicating that he needed someone capable of implementing the war on drugs on a national level, replicating the Davao model. The Davao model referred to the system involving payment and reward. The Davao model involves 3 levels of payment of reward. First is the reward if the suspect is killed. Second, if is the funding of planned operations. And the third is the refund of operational expenses.
Colonel Garma, can you speak louder? I'm sorry, speak closer to the microphone.
Initially, I informed the President that I was unaware of any individual with those qualifications as I had not been assigned outside of Davao City or had served in the national capacity within the PNP. However, I recalled my upperclassman Edilberto Leonardo, who was heading the Criminal Investigation Detection Group and was also a member of the Iglesia Ni Cristo. I mentioned his name to the president. On the same day, a certain individual named Muking contacted me to request for the phone number of Leonardo's contact details, which I promptly provided. A week later, I learned from Arthur Narsolis via phone call that Sir Leonardo had been summoned and was instructed to proceed to the Royal Mandaya Hotel in Davao for a meeting. Leonardo informed me later that he stayed at the hotel for almost 3 days, during which the president directed him to organize, according to Sir Leonardo, a task force, which he understood as PAOK TF. When Leonardo relayed this information, urged me to join the task force, I declined first, citing my lack of experience in handling said operations. Leonardo subsequently informed me that he had prepared a proposal routed to Bongo outlining the task force, which would encompass Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. I am afraid of my life, Mr. Chair, and the life of my relatives and my friends and classmates. Leonardo subsequently informed me that he had prepared a proposal routed to Bongo confirming the task force operation, which would encompass Luzon, Visayas, Mindanao. He also inquired if he and his classmates could have a courtesy call with the president through Bongo for a photo opportunity. Considering this, I thought it prudent to invite also my classmates to join the courtesy call. So in the presence of Colonel Bacay, Villela, Grijaldo, Tuzon, and Dueñas, the member of class 97 and 96 were accommodated in separate rooms at the DPWH office in Panacan, Davao City. The president did not enter our room, and I was unaware if he visited the room of class 96. After the courtesy call, Leonardo informed me that the structure of the mentioned task force would undergo changes. In June of 2016, Leonardo has transferred from Manila to assume the position of the chief of the CIDG Region 11. During the initial 3 months of the assignment, I facilitated all meetings between Leonardo and Bongo at Leonardo's request. Subsequently, they established direct communication. Leonardo informed me that he had recalled several trusted personnel, namely Lester, Romel Bactat, Rodel Serbo, Palma, Peter Parungo to serve as operative for the task force, notably Bactat, Serbo, and Palma were for now discharged from the police service. Romel Baktat, Serbo, Palma were all former police officers stationed at the CIDG 11 office. They were discharged from the service on or about a year ago due to an operation that led to the killing of one individual. Lester Bergaño is a provide citizen, while Peter Parunga was a former detainee of CIDG due to a charge of rape that has been cleared. Romel Baktat, Serbo, Palma, and Parunga were charged with the task of collecting and verifying informations provided by police officers in the field concerning arrests, deaths of individuals named in the list of drug personalities, and creating summary reports. All of these reports would then be encoded and compiled by Lester Bergaño. The compilation is thereafter elevated to Sir Leonardo, who will decide what level the arrest or killing was and its corresponding reward. Rewards were only given for killings, while for arrest, only for the funding of Copland and refund for operational expenses was given. I saw how these individuals operated when I would visit my friend in CIDG 11. He conveyed that the task force would be structured differently and that he submitted a document to Bongo detailing the task force operation, including an overview of the current drug landscape in the Philippines. I was informed that the drug structure originated from Bucor, where numerous drug lords are currently incarcerated, and that it has three branches, Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao, with Peter Lim involved in the Visayas region. Once the task force became operational, I later learned that all Copland's funds, refunds for operational expenses, and rewards for agents were processed through the account of Peter Parungo. Currently, Lester Bergaño maintained a comprehensive list of the drug personalities of the Philippines. Leonardo conducted briefings for all PDEA, IG regional directors, and PNP chiefs regarding the drug situation. Additionally, if any individual died during police operations, Leonardo will report the incidents to Bongo for inclusion in the weekly report and request for refunds of operational expenses. Leonardo had final authority to determine who would be included in the list of drug personalities and to classify their threat level, as well as the discretion to remove individuals from the list. Furthermore, in 2016, while I was at the CIDG office following up the appointments of my personnel, I overheard Padilla discussing drug activities at the Davao Penal Connolly with Leonardo. Padilla specifically identified certain Bucor officers involved in drug trade, notably mentioning an officer named Ginto, who was subsequently killed along with other Bucor members. These are the critical facts I personally know regarding the drug war of the previous administration. I am prepared to provide additional details and information in a supplemental affidavit or during an executive session at the discretion of the committee. I affirm the truthfulness and accuracy of the above statements to assist in the investigation by the Joint Committee, Your Honors.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead, SDS.
Mr. Chairman, alam mo, papasalamat ako kay Ma'am Garma. And no, alam po natin ang nararamdaman mo.
Pero kaya ako umakyat, nanonood po ako sa TV, sa baba. Mukhang itong committee na to, parang pinilit ka para magsalita. Kaya ka umiyak. Baka sabihin ang Quadcom, pinilit ka para magsumite ng affidavit at basahin mo. Umiyak ka. So, gusto po namin kasi na pakita mo talaga na kusang loob ang sasabihin mo dito sa Quadcom. Wala pong sapilitan at galing po sa puso nyo ang pagsasalita. So, kaya po ako umakyat na sa baba ako, kausap ko yung mga ibang kasama natin. Ma'am Garma, alam ko naman po yung sitwasyon nyo. May nanonood po sa atin buong Pilipinas, lalo na sa Mindanao. Alam ko po kung ano nararamdaman nyo. Pero pakita nyo naman po, in the interest of fairness of every Filipino, pakita po natin yung fairness dito. Kung titingnan nyo po yung mukha nyo sa TV, ang analisa po namin, parang itong committee na to, which is ako na bigla, may affidavit kayo. Kaya ako po sana, kung pwede, kasi hindi po naiintindihan yung mga binabasa nyo, yung mga nanonood. Yung affidavit nyo, hindi po naiintindihan yung mga televiewers natin. Kung kayo nandito, naiintindihan nyo, pero pag nasa TV kayo, hindi nyo po naiintindihan yung mga sinasabi nyo. Mr. Chair, on that note, kung pwede po, magpahingat siya, huwag siya umiyak, sabihin niya lahat in a clear reading, in a clear words. Ako po, I move sana para basahin niya ulit yung kanyang affidavit, Mr. Chairman. Salamat po.
Siguro, Ms. Rowena Garma, we will give you time to be composed. And we cannot blame you doon sa inyong emotion. Ako rin, nabigla din ako doon sa... kasi it's a sudden turnaround, no? From the last mga hearings po natin. And suddenly, we will be receiving an affidavit like this, no? Siguro, malapat lamang pong sabihin natin sa committee to kung somebody forces you to execute an affidavit like this. That a while ago, the reason why we're asking Congressman Manuel to hold his gun, kasi nga I was able to see the affidavits and I really wanted to read muna for a while. And 4 pages lang naman po yun. So, nakakagulat din po yung nilalaman ng inyong affidavit dahil a complete turnaround. So, meron po bang pumilit sa inyo para i-execute itong affidavit na to?
Wala po, Mr. Chair. It took me 1 week to make some reflections po.
And what pushes you execute?
I realize the truth will always set us free, Mr. Chair. And at least I will be able to contribute if we really want to make this country a better place to live and for our children. I think we have to do something para maibalik po yung trust sa PNP, magkaroon po ng reform sa PNP, and yung tiwala po ng mga tao, whether victims of criminals sa gobyerno.
Kanina po may sinasabi kayo na natatakot kayo sa buhay niyo at sa pamilya niyo. Saan po kayo natatakot?
Of course po, it's normal, Mr. Chair, when you speak the truth, you cannot please everyone. And it's normal to anybody to have that mixed emotion. But still, it took me 1 week to make reflections. And I realized I need to do my part po.
Dahil po ba sa relasyon niyo sa nakaraang administrasyon kay former president? Kaya po ang damdamin niyo po ay mixed emotion?
Normal lang naman bilang tao po, Mr. Chair. Pero what prevailed after a week of reflection is I always say the truth will always set me free.
We are
I want a better place. a better PNP, Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, Ma'am Garma, we are all on the same page. Kaya ginagawa po natin to para sa taong bayan, maayos yung PNP, mawala ang extrajudicial killing, yung drugs. Kaya nandito po tayo. Yung sinasabi niyo po, we are totally agree on that. Kaya gusto ko lang pong i-clear at sinagot niyo na walang pumilit, nag-meditate ka for how many days before you prepare that affidavit na bigla nga ako ngayong Quadcom hearing na meron po kayong affidavit. So on that note, Ma'am Garma, pag-compose na po kayo, ayos na po kayo, pwede niyo po ulit basahin ang inyong affidavit. Salamat po, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. SDS, are we going to ask Ms. Garma to read again?
Please, Mr. Chairman.
Yung kanyang affidavit, no? We hope, kasi kanina medyo hindi ko rin po naiintindihan, no? Luckily, I was able to read na yung ating pong affidavit. So, siguro kung compose na po kayo, para po maintindihan, kasi napaka-importante po nito, no? Nung binabasa ko din po, medyo na-shock din po ako. So, basically, siguro, we will give you another chance para po mabasa itong affidavit as requested and moved by SDS Don Gonzales. So, now, you have the floor again, Ma'am Rowena Garma.
On September 12, 2024 and September 27, 2024, I was invited to serve as a resource person during the recent legislative inquiry conducted by the Joint Committee on Drugs.
Ma'am, can you put the mic a little bit closer to your mouth, please?
Yes, sir. During these hearings, I was asked several questions concerning my knowledge or involvement in the deaths of three Chinese inmates at the double penal colony and the death of General Wesley Barayuga, all focusing on the alleged extrajudicial killings of the aforementioned individuals. I was also questioned about my relationship with the former president, as well as my career as a police officer and my tenure as the GM of the Philippine Charity Sweepstakes Office. Throughout the hearings, I answered questions from the committee based on my personal knowledge. However, I did so with great apprehension as I recognized that my statements on national television could significantly endanger my life, the safety of my family, and others close to me. After considerable reflection, I am now executing this affidavit to provide a comprehensive information to the Quadcom regarding everything I personally know about the war on drugs during the former administration. On May of 2016, I received a call from the then President Rodrigo Duterte at approximately 5 in the morning, instructing me to meet him at his residence in Doña Luisa, Davao City. I was already acquainted with then Mayor Duterte, having served as a station commander in one of the police stations in Davao during his tenure. During our meeting, he requested that I locate a PNP officer or operative who is a member of the Iglesia Ni Cristo, indicating that he needed someone capable of implementing the war on drugs on a national scale, replicating the Davao model. The Davao model referred to the shifting system involving payment and rewards. The Davao model involves three levels of payments of rewards. The first is the reward if the suspect is killed. Second is the funding of planned operations. Third is the refund of operational expenses. Initially, I informed the president that I was unaware of any individual with those qualifications as I had not been assigned outside of Davao, nor had I served in a national capacity with the PNP. However, I recalled my upperclassman, Edilberto Leonardo, who was handling the Criminal Investigation Detection Group and was also a member of the Iglesia Ni Cristo. I mentioned his name to the president. On the same day, a certain individual named Muking contacted me by the phone to request Leonardo's contact details, which I promptly provided. A week later, I learned from Arthur Narsolis via phone call that Leonardo had been summoned and was instructed to proceed to Royal Mandaya Hotel for a meeting. Leonardo informed me that he stayed at the hotel for 3 days, during which the president directed him to organize a task force similar to PAOC TF. When Leonardo relayed this information and urged me to join the task force, I declined, citing my lack of experience in handling such operations. Leonardo subsequently informed me that he had prepared a proposal routed through Bongo, outlining the task force operations, which would encompass Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. He also inquired if he and his classmates could have a courtesy call with the president through Bongo for a photo opportunity. Considering this, I thought it would be prudent also to invite my classmates, Bakay, Vilela, Grijaldo, Tuzon, and Dueñas, to join the courtesy call. The members of Class 97 and Class 96 of PNPA were accommodated in a separate room at the TPWH office in Panacan, Davao. The president did not enter our room, and I was unaware if he visited the room of Class 96. This is 96, sir, not 97. After the call to see call, Leonardo informed me that the structure of the intended task force would undergo changes. In June of 2016, Leonardo was transferred from Manila to assume the position of the chief of the CIDG in Region 11. During the initial 3 months of this assignment, I facilitated all meetings between Leonardo and Bongo at Leonardo's request. Subsequently, the established direct communications. Leonardo informed me that he had recalled several trusted personnel, namely, I met Lester Bergaño, Romel Bactat, Rodel Serbo, Michael Palma, and Peter Parungo to serve as operatives for the task force. Notably, Romel Bactat, Rodel Serbo, and Michael Parma were all discharged as police officers. Romel Bactat and Romel Serbo, Michael Palma were all former police officers stationed at CIDG 11 office. They were discharged from service on or about a year ago due to an operation that led to the killing of one individual. Lester Bergaño is a private citizen, while Peter Parungo was a former detainee in CIDG due to a charge of rape that has been cleared. Romel Bactat, Rodel Serbo, Michael Palma, and Peter Parungo were charged with the task force of collecting, verifying informations provided by police officers in the field concerning arrests or deaths of individuals named in the list of drug personalities, and creating a summary report. All of these reports would then be encoded, compiled by Lester Bergaño. The compilation is thereafter elevated to Leonardo, who will then decide what level the arrest or killing was and its corresponding reward. Rewards were only given for killings, while for arrests, only the funding of the coplan and a refund for the expenses was given. I saw how this individual operated when I would visit the CIDG office in Region 11 to see my friend Lot Lot. He also conveyed to me that the task force would be structured differently, in that he submitted a document to Bongo detailing the task force operation, including an overview of the current drug landscape in the Philippines. I was also informed that the drug structure originated from Bucor, where numerous drug lords are currently incarcerated, in that it has three branches, Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao, with Peter Lim involved in the Visayas region. Once the task force became operational, I later learned that all Coplan funds, refunds for operational expenses, and rewards against for agents were processed through the bank accounts of Peter Parungo at Metrobank, BDO, and PS Bank. Concurrently, Lester Borgaño maintained a comprehensive list of the drug personalities in the Philippines. Leonardo conducted briefings for Orpidea, IG, regional directors, and PNP chiefs regarding the operations. Additionally, if any individual died during police operation, Leonardo would report the incident to Bongo for inclusion in his weekly report and request for refunds of operational expenses. Leonardo had the final authority to determine who would be included on the list of drug personalities and to classify their threat levels, as well as the discretion to remove individuals from the list. Furthermore, in 2016, while I was at the CIDG office, following up on personal appointments, I overheard Superintendent Padilla of Bucor discussing drug activities at the Davao Penal Colony with Leonardo. Padilla specifically mentioned certain Bucor officers involved in the drug trade, notably mentioning an officer named Ginto, who was subsequently killed along with other Bucor members. These are the critical facts I personally know regarding the drug war of the previous administration. I am prepared to provide additional details and information in the supplemental affidavit or during an executive session at the discretion of the committee. I affirm the truthfulness and accuracy of the above statement to assist in the investigation by the Joint Committee on Dangerous Drugs, Public Order and Safety, Human Rights, and Public Accounts of the Honorable House of Representatives, the QuadCom. Mr. Chair.
Tapos na po kayo, ma'am?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
So, on that note, ma'am, maraming salamat ulit sa pagbasa niyo sa inyong affidavit. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Congressman Gonzalez. So, the first to interpolate Colonel Garma is Congressman Raul Manuel. You have 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, I'm actually shocked by the contents of the affidavit. So I'll be asking clarificatory questions. I'll be focusing dun sa nabanggit na reward system, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, sa affidavit ni Colonel Garma, binanggit niya na siya ay dating pinatawag ni former President Rodrigo Duterte. Nung pinatawag siya, ibinahagi ba yung plano na i-implement nationwide yung war on drugs? Tama po ba?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair, nung mayor si former President Rodrigo Duterte sa Davao, implemented na doon ang war on drugs based sa kung paano natin siya ngayon napoperceive. Tama po ba?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Okay, Mr. Chair, at least ngayon, buti po ay na-admit iyon ni Colonel Garma dahil nung nakaraang mga pagtanong po natin ay hindi pa agad din yon na napuput on record dito sa committee. At least po ngayon ay alam na po natin talaga once and for all. Mr. Chair, nung station commander si Colonel Garma, nung panahon ni former President Rodrigo Duterte as mayor, ibig sabihin po ba nun ay, given her role, isa po siya sa mga nag-implement ng war on drugs sa Davao. Tama po ba iyon, Mr. Chair?
Paki-clarify mo lang yung question.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, ang tanong ko po dahil naging station commander po si Colonel Garma noong Davao Mayor si Rodrigo Duterte. So ibig sabihin po nun, given her role, ay isa po siya sa mga nag-implement ng war on drugs sa Davao.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair, nag-implement po siya noon dahil kasama po siya dun sa mga na-mention kanina from NUPL, yung Davao Boys and Girls. Tama po ba, Mr. Chair?
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, can I explain my answer, Mr. Chair, so that maintindihan po ni Congressman?
Sige.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Pakilapit lang po yung microphone sa inyong
This is how it works, actually. Pag mag-conduct po ng police operation, kasi po ang police, if the operation po is successful and you file the case in court, you will submit a report sa City Hall monthly at nakalagay po doon na na-file po yung kaso, nakalagay din po yung IS number po, proof na na-file po yung kaso and the details of the case. And once i-submit mo to, yung operational expenses po ay nare-refund. That's 5,000 pesos per case po, per operation. Ngayon po, kung malaki po yung operation mo at kailangan mo ng operational fund, gagawa ka ng COPLAN, you will also request po sa City Hall for the funding of the operation plan. Now, in case din po na nagkaroon po ng operation and subsequently po nagkaroon po ng death on the part of the suspects po during illegitimate operation, meron din pong corresponding amount po na binibigay, Mr. Chair. So that is how it works po.
So, Mr. Chair, ibig sabihin ay totoo ngang merong Davao Boys and Girls na nagpatupad ng war on drugs. To confirm, Mr. Chair, tama po. Na yun yung mode of operations as described. Tama po ba? Yun yung kinakandak, yun yung ginagawa nitong Davao Boys and Girls.
Ganun po yung sistema po ng how you will refund yung operational expenses. Kung ano po yung tawag nila at ano po yung ipinangalan, ay for me, it's not relevant as long as yung process on how the funds are being provided po, yun po yung in-explain ko lang po. If that is how po ang pag-perceive, that's how it is politically described po, then that's it po.
Okay, Mr. Chair, dun sa reward system, kasi nasa affidavit din po, na nire-refund ang operational expenses. Tapos may funding din para sa plant operations. Ito yung co-plan. Tapos may reward din kapag napatay yung suspect. Tama po ba, Mr. Chair?
Yes po, Your Honor.
Mr. Chair, may nakuha po kasi tayong impormasyon. Although nung mga nakaraan ay parang haka-haka lang siya, pero ngayon na nag-hold tayo ng investigations, ay nakakakuha po tayo ng mga sources na pagdating po dun sa reward system, ay kapag ang napatay ay isang pusher, yun yung tinatawag na level 1, tapos 50,000 ang reward. Makakonfirm po ba yun ni Colonel Garma, Mr. Chair?
Mr. Chair, I am not so familiar po sa specific amounts. But true, there is a amount po per level. I think Colonel Leonardo can explain po kung ano yung specific amount. Kapag baka magkamali po akong sasabihin na 50 nga o 100 o 1 million yun. But there is a corresponding amount per level, Mr. Chair.
Sige. Mr. Chair, sa information na nakuha natin ay merong apat na levels. Yung level 1 ay 50K para sa pusher. Kung napatay ay pusher. Kung big time pusher naman ay yun yung level 2, 100K. Tapos kung narco cops, narco politicians or protectors ay 300 to 500K. Tapos kapag trader, manufacturer, chemist, yung mga ninja cops or mga financiers, yun yung level 4, 1 million yung reward kapag napatay sila. Familiar po ba yun kay Colonel Garma? Yung ganong leveling and amounts?
May amount po, Mr. Chair, from what I understand, starting 20,000 to 1 million. But I'm not familiar sa mga bracketing po, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair, yung 20K... yun po yung mga street level or mga small time na natatag na involved sa drug trade. Tama po ba?
Most likely kasi yun po yung pinakamaliit na amount as far as that's I know, Mr. Chair.
And to compare, Mr. Chair, yung mga napatay dun sa Davao Penal Colony ay dahil ang kanilang task di umano doon sa drug trade ay yung pagiging mga chemist. Kaya kapag ganun, level 4 sila. Kaya naging 1 million per head yung presyo, kumbaga, or yung reward para sa pagpatay sa kanila. Tapos dahil tatlo sila, kaya 3 million. Tama po ba, Mr. Chair?
Hindi ko po alam, Mr. Chair, kaya hindi ko nakita kung magkano ang, kung talagang mayroon pong naklasify sila kung anong level. Ay, hindi ko po nakita kasi.
Pero you can confirm na yung pinakamataas ay 1 million.
As far as I know, Mr. Chair.
Okay, Mr. Chair, dun sa pag-implement ng war on drugs on a national level, dun sa pakikipag-usap ni Colonel Garma kay former President Rodrigo Duterte, sinabi ba niya na meron siyang layunin na yung Davao model ay i-implement sa buong bansa? May ganun po ba, Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
And Mr. Chair, dun sa ganitong plano ay on loop po doon ang incumbent senator na si Bongo. Tama po ba?
Mr. Chair, I didn't get the question. Kindly repeat po, Your Honor.
Mr. Chair, dun sa plano na itong Davao model ay implement siya sa buong bansa, based sa naging affidavit, gusto nating makonfirm na mayroong papel din dito si Senator Bongo. Tama po ba?
Sa aking understanding, it would appear, Mr. Chair, kasi po siya ang minimit ni Sir Leonardo.
Mr. Chair, kapag may napatay na suspect doon sa drug trade, kanino unang nire-report yung mga instances na merong napatay?
Sa ground kasi may gagawa ka ng report, Mr. Chair, spot report. And then, meron pong phone number na na-disseminate sa lahat po ng RD, PD, Chief of Police, kung saan po tinetext po yung result ng police operation. And these phone numbers are handled, hinahawakan po ng mga tao po ni Sir Leonardo.
Mr. Chair, since naging bahagi po si Colonel Garma ng War on Drugs sa Davao, familiar po ba siya kung, or alam po ba niya kung meron ding competition sa iba't ibang mga police stations sa number ng mga napatay? Lalo na kung meron palang reward na napatay yung isang tao as compared to inaresto lang. So meron bang ganong tipo ng competition among police stations?
Wala po, Mr. Chair, during our time.
Mr. Chair, pagdating naman sa kung paano na-incentivize yung mga iba't ibang police stations or police officers, ano po yung mga pamantayan dati para masabi na ang isang police station ay effective sa pagkandak niya ng war on drugs?
Meron kasing sa amin nung sa Davao kasi po, it depends po kasi sa station na hinahawakan mo kasi naka-profile na po yan kung anong classification po ng drugs, kung infested po ba ng drugs yung mga barangay. So meron na pong projection po kasi meron po kami noong tinatawag na yung may baseline po kasi kami na naka-establish during that time. So projected po kung ilan ang possible arrest mo every month, Mr. Chair. But of course, dumarating din po yung point na wala ka na mahuli o sobrang baba. Depende kasi sa performance din ng patrol sa area as part of preventing po yung occurrence po ng illegal drug trade. So mamimili ka lang naman eh, mag-ooperate ka o intensify mo ang police patrol para wala kang mahuli at hindi po matuloy mangyari ang bentahan po ng droga. You just choose between the two naman po.
Kaya, Mr. Chair, yun yung tungkol sa reward system kapag may napatay na mga suspect. Kahit nga, we would like to underscore na mga suspect pa lang yun. Mr. Chair, pagdating dun sa funding ng mga planned operations, sino po ang nagfa-fund ng mga ganong operasyon, yung tinatawag na co-plan batay dun sa affidavit?
What I understand pong alam ko po, pag malalaking police operation, the case operation plan ay sinasubmit po kay Sir Leonardo for funding. And I think si Sir Leonardo po maka-explain kung saan po galing ang pondo, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair, sa pagkakaalam ni Colonel Garma, meron bang mga private individuals or corporations na nagbibigay din ng, kumbaga, we can say donation para sa ganitong mga planned operations?
I'm not aware, Mr. Chair. Wala akong alam po.
Mr. Chair, pare-pareho ba yung amount na binibigay para dun sa kada operation na kinakonduct?
Hindi ko rin po alam, Mr. Chair, kasi hindi ako ang nag-evaluate ng mga co-plan. Basta ang alam ko lang, sinasubmit po sa kanya and siya po ang magpa-facilitate for the funding, Mr. Chair.
Okay. And Mr. Chair, dun sa pangatlong tipo ng itong paggamit ng pera for these plans, yung refund for operational expenses, ano-ano pong mga tipo ng expenses ito? Kasi kung nire-refund siya, ibig sabihin, meron munang nag-aabono. Ganun po ba ang sistema sa pag-conduct ng mga operations? Nag-aabono muna yung mga involved na mga police, tapos saka sila manghihingi ng refund?
I will explain further, Mr. Chair. Yung real Makoy kasi sa ground, Mr. Chair. The real talk po tayo sa ground. Eh talaga namang wala pong pondo talaga. Mag-aabono ka talaga. Pati by bus money, mag-aabono ang chief of police dyan para mamarkahin yan. Kung minsan nasusunog na itatakbo, wala na. Tapos wala kang mahuli, hindi mo talaga marerefund yung pera mo. So talagang abonado ang chief of police at saka mga operatiba. That is why in Davao, once successful po ang police operation na file mo ang kaso, may IS number po, proof that you filed the case, i-refund po ng 5,000 pesos yung mga expenses like photocopy, buy bus money, payment for the agent, pagkain po ng suspect pag dinala mo po sa court, kasi maghihintay ka rin, tatagal ka rin sa korte. So those are the expenses which is very decent enough naman, just enough para lang maibalik at ma-refund po yung mga personal expenses na nagastos po ng chief of police o ng mga operatiba during police operation, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair, dun sa mga nagpapa-refund for operational expenses, saan o kanino kinukuha yung mga pang-refund na mga amounts?
Are we referring to the national scope, Mr. Chair? My question lang, or Davao?
Sa Davao,
Davao noon, we have to submit the after activity report sa City Hall po. And then may pipirmahan kang voucher na ma-refund yung lahat ng expenses.
How about nung naging national na or nationwide na yung scale ng implementation ng war on drugs? Kanino din kinukuha yung refund?
Lahat po ay kay Colonel Leonardo, Mr. Chair.
Okay. So far, Mr. Chair, mas yun muna yung aking mga tanong. Pero so far, based sa mga narinig natin hanggang ngayon, Mr. Chair, inabsorb ko pa rin talaga dahil hindi usual na marinig natin na merong nag-confirm na meron talagang reward system, yung mga amounts, ranging from yung small time pala na mga kahit inosente, 20,000 yung presyo para sa kanila. Tapos yung mga big time, kumbaga, tig 1 million bawat ulo. And from Davao ay naging massive ito hanggang sa buong bansa. Kaya naman pala ganado yung mga sangkot ng mga pulis na kapag neutralization talaga ang layunin ay pumatay dahil pala ganun kalaki yung reward na kanila makukuha, Mr. Chair. So yun muna sa ngayon. Maraming salamat.
Okay, salamat Congressman Manuel. Deputy Speaker Suarez.
Just a little bit of clarification to the points raised by Congressman Manuel. Colonel Garma, you mentioned earlier na dati po kayong chief of police ng Cebu. Tama po yun?
Yes, Your Honor. Yeah.
Can you speak louder?
Kasi yes, Your Honor, Mr. Yeah. Chair.
At kanina po, nung ginaganap po yung hearing dito, nagdadatingan po yung mga biktima under your watch. And a lot of these victims actually flew in from Cebu. Earlier today, with the interpellation of Congressman Manuel, you confirmed that there was a reward system with regards to the implementation of the drug war. Can you further explain how this reward system was implemented while you were the head cop of the city of Cebu?
Mr. Chair, during my stint as the city director of Cebu po, yung mga station commanders ay directly reporting to R2. So, pagka may mga incident po, kasi po, widespread yung phone number naman eh. Lahat po ng chief of police yan, makonfirm, mayroon silang number kung saan sila magte-text.
So, ulit lang po, sorry, hindi ko narinig.
Widespread po yung number kung saan po sila magte-text. During my time po, wala po nagte-text sa akin para ibato ko kay Sir Leonardo para bayaran. Hindi po ganun ang setup sa Cebu. The chief of police would directly report sa R2 po. Alam niyo po, Mr. Chair, during the drug war, sometimes po may mga nababypass din ng mga commanders. Kasi po, ang control is either direct control ng RD or direct control ng R2 or ng mga special units or task force. And sometimes, hindi naman yung territorial police po ang may project nun. Tumatawid po.
Yes, thank you for sharing that, Colonel Garma, but I think it's a little bit hard for me to accept that statement because, you know, you're the chief of police of Cebu. Cebu being a highly urbanized city, usually my regional directors will actually respect, and I'm sure some of the police officers would confirm this, with regards to how you supervise, manage the affairs of the PNP in that area. So, again, just to...
Can I explain, Mr. Chair?
Yes, okay, please.
As far as my role po doon, sir, I make sure lang po na ma-investigate in case na may mga ganong incident. Naka-crimes, napaprocess ang crime scene, and then kung ayaw po ng biktima na kami mag-imbestiga, ay inaalaw po namin yung NBI to take cognizance. Ganun po yung setup. As to yung pong, kung may mga incident like namatay, I never, hindi po ako ang hanggang ispat report lang po nakakarating.
Oh, sige. Dagdag lang doon sa tanong with the indulgence of Congressman Suarez. Yung, paano, sino nagde-determine kung sino magiging provincial director, chief of police, at saka yung mga community precinct commanders? Sino ang nagde-determine nun? Dito, in the context of the drug war, ha? Halimbawa, si example natin, si Colonel Patay. No, Colonel Patay, you were previously assigned sa Davao, tama?
Davao del Norte po, Your Honor.
Davao del Norte.
Mr. Chair.
And then, sinong nag-order na ilipat si Colonel Patay dito sa Quezon City? Would you know kung sino yan? Is that part of the system na merong isa na naglilista? Dito ilalagay si Colonel Patay, dito ilalagay si...
Mr. Chair, kasi nagiging culture po kasi ng PNP po na pag ang RD ay malipat o ang PD, may dinadala pong opisyal. Okay? So, yung iba, pagdala mo yung opisyal, pwede mong ilagay kung saang pwesto na qualified naman po silang ilagay. Pero, during that time po, meron din pong sitwasyon na some would volunteer that they...
Volunteer?
Yeah.
So, merong nagbo-volunteer?
Nagbo-volunteer. Which is, I think naman po, is nagagrant kung minsan because they would say that they can deliver.
And what can they deliver? Ano yung bakit, ano?
Mga projects po sa area, sa war on drugs.
Be specific, para lang for our education, kasi hindi naman namin naintindihan. Yeah. Yung sinabi mong project, ano yun?
Example po, Mr. Chair, alimbawa lang po, like, mag-regional chief ka, halimbawa po, ng isang unit sa IDG. In the case po of Sir Marcos po.
Si Colonel Marcos?
Yeah. Okay. I think mayroong arrangement
Colonel,
yan.
Colonel, can you speak louder? Yes.
May arrangement niya na he could deliver mga big fish in the area. So, just to give him the opportunity to lead the unit, it's easier. Mga ganun po, yung iba naman po, nakakapagtrabaho, tama naman po yung trabaho, hindi naman po lahat po ay masasabi mong hindi tama po yung ginawa.
Ano bang ibig sabihin nung makaka-deliver? Halimbawa, is Colonel Marcos still here, no? So, anong ibig sabihin nung makaka-deliver?
It's a lingo po sa PNP during that time na if you use the word deliver ay mahuhuli mo yung malaking big fish.
Mahuhuli?
Level 1, level 2 at sigurado po patay po.
In the case of Colonel Marcos, siya ba yung nag-volunteer?
Ang pagkakaalam ko po.
Siya nag-volunteer?
Yes,
sige.
Sir.
Mamaya,
pagkakaalam ko lang po.
Tatanungin natin siya. So, in order for us to understand fully kung ano yung konteksto nung sinasabing drug war, In the previous hearing, Chairman Acop has tasked the Director General of the BITEA, no, to help us understand ano ba itong drug list, ano ba itong narco list. And in that request by Congressman Acop, we put that into motion where during that time, it was unanimously approved by the committee. So may we ask now the PIDEA kung meron ba kayong pwedeng i-submit, ipakitang report dito sa committee ito?
Yes, Your Honor. We will show to you how the drug list came about. And this is very crucial in relation to the story of Ms. Garma.
So, in other words, DG, masusuportahan nyo yung sinasabi ni Colonel Garma?
As far as the making of the drug list, sir, is concerned.
Okay, will you submit to us or are you going to make a presentation?
We will give you a copy, sir, but again, we ask for your indulgence. Please find time to look at it because we assure you that after we finish the presentation, you will understand how this list came about.
And, sige, please.
Yes, sir. I would like to request our Director for Intelligence, Director Bitong, sir, to brief.
Okay. So, with the indulgence of the members of the committee, we will allow the PIDEA to make this presentation or this report before the Quadcom. Please proceed.
Please bear with me, sir, as I try to read it so that I can deliver it crisply and clearly. This is based. We tried to be very faithful to the data that were made available to us. Next. So actually, sir, what I'm showing is the history of the PRR, this list. In several occasions, the former president showed lists and mentioned drug personalities in his public appearances. On August 7, 2016, he mentioned Mayor Mabilog along with 159 others. Next. In December 2016, the first president drug list, or popularly known as PRR, the list or narco list, was obtained. On September 28, 2017, the second list was obtained. This was merged with the first list. The total personalities combined were now at 6,191. On October 19, 2017, during the technical working group meeting, the TWG included in the list the personalities mentioned by PRRD on August 7, 2016. Thus, the total 6,221. 30 out of 159 new personalities were added. The others also mentioned were already in the list. In March 2018, the third list with 6,623 was received. The first, second, and third list was combined, removing redundancies, resulting to a total of 6,562 personalities. During this period, series of intelligence workshops, the crafting of policies and guidelines, and remedied subcommittee meetings were conducted. It was on 28 May 2019 when the President's drug list was renamed Interagency Drug Information Database, or IDID. From May 14, 2021 to April 7, 2022, three remedied committee meetings were conducted. Out of 1,046 POIs adjudicated by the remedied committee, only 885 were approved. 600 POIs recommended for deletion, 249 for relegation to suspense file, and 36 for retention, and 153 POIs remain pending. This is the current IDID, the working database that is the product of PREMIDID from the first, second, and third list. Upon the assumption of PBBM, the committee members conducted several consultation meetings. A letter signed by current SILG as chairman, the former SILG, as chairman of PREMIDID committee, proposing the dissolution of the remedied guidelines and procedures was forwarded to the Office of the President on May 24, 2024. This is yet to be approved. Meanwhile, the different regional adjudication committees are continuously deliberating their IDID. In our effort to come up with a comprehensive study, PIDEA obtained the following e-copies, as shown. When PIDEA was tasked to study the origin of PRRD list, PIDEA gathered versions from other sources, as shown. First on the list is the new target list. It is the file name. It was recovered from old PIDEA files. The original list in August 2020 was acquired by the Director General of PIDEA on September 2024. The PRRD list, Pro-NIR, was recovered by the Deputy Director General for Operation, ASEC Renato Gumban. And the IDID list is the working database maintained by PIDEA, processed from first, second, the PRRD pronouncement, and the third list. I will show you, sir, the details of the different list. Going to the details, shown are the properties and contents of the different list. Comparing the five Excel e-copies, we come up with the following results. New target list and original list are the same with 3,981 names. The August 2020 NPRRD list Pro-NIR have minor differences. File name PRRD list Pro-NIR has only 31 worksheets compared to August 2020 with 32 because it contains worksheet NIR. IDID, the official list of PREMIDID committee, has a total of 6,276. Let me just note that Attorney Wesley A. Barayuga, the PCSO official killed on July 30, 2020, was included in August 2020 in PRRD list Pro-NIR, but never in IDID. Going deeper, sir, you will note, sir, that the new target list is authored by PNP-CIDG as well as the original list, PNP-CIDG. And the next, the August 2020, is authored by a certain Iyanism as well as PRRD list, Pro-NIR. While the IDID has no more author because this is a working database. Upon checking the properties of the same five Excel files, particularly the original list, it has the PNP-CIDG and Yanism as the authors, four of which were created last July 25, 2016, while the IDID was created last November 15, 2022, because, as I said, it is a working database and properties change every updating. The next slide. This is what we were talking about earlier. This slide shows notable differences among the lists. On the left is worksheet found in the new target list and original list. This contains five levels with description and a column for amount. On the right is worksheet found in file name August 2020 and PRRD list Pro-NIR. These have only four levels with description and an evaluation. These do not have the amount column. In the audit list, all these worksheets are not included. Next. This slide is a photo gallery of high value target found in the list. On the left, the new target list, original list, and audit list contain fewer photos than the one on the right with file name August 2020 and PRRD list Pro NIR. On the next slide, shows a photo gallery of alleged Binondo personalities found on the list. Just like the previous slide, the new target list, original list, and ID list on the left contain fewer photos than the one on the right with file name August 2020 and PRRD list Pro NIR. In both lists, DAPICOL personalities Jackson Lee and Wong Meng Pin are included. Our findings. There is indeed the President's Drug List, commonly known as PRRD List. All four lists obtained were authored on July 25, 2016. File name, new target list, and original list are both authored by PNP CIDG. The file name PRRD, Pro NIR, and August 2020 have same author, Yianism. These were recently obtained and did not undergo official validation by the remedied. There are many inconsistencies and differences between the different lists. The counts of personalities vary. There are double or triple entries, many aliases, insufficient details. The tab high-value target of personalities with some names on the picture gallery are not included in the list. There are also inconsistent recapitulation and numbering on the sheets. The three Chinese killed in DAPICOL are included in the list. The original list contained the amount column. Mayor Mabilog was not included in the original list until October 19, 2017, 2 months after second list was received. And attorney Wesley Barayuga was included only in August 2020 and PRRD list Pro NIR, but never in IDID or the official list. That ends our briefing, sir.
Mr. Chair, can I have just some clarificatory question?
Please proceed.
Yeah, thank you very much. Just to the PDEA, nabanggit niyo po kanina, based on what I gather, it was a list that was having a lot of revisions from the time that it started, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
So, if it was being revised continuously, we were seeing deaths left and right since 2016 onwards.
Yes, Your Honor.
So, how can we now say that those deaths and those operations were indeed validated through drug personalities? If the list itself that served as the basis of the PNP to implement was not validated, nor was it final in nature?
That was the predicament that we had while we were trying to analyze the lists, Your Honor, because we found out that, let us just take for example the first list or the original list. It was sent to PDEA, it was studied by PDEA, and when it was submitted back to the palace, that is what I understand, a second list would be given back to PDEA. And it was observed that there would be names included in the list that was being sent back to PDEA. So parang, ano sir, we checked on the list, we sent it forward, we sent it upwards for them to check on it, hoping that it wouldn't be, there would be no more names included, but it was on the, it was the opposite. There would be names again that would be included. And so this continued until the third list. Mr. And so Chair, as not to miss anything, we already, so as not to miss anything, the lists were already combined with each other to come up with the August 2020 list, removing the names that were redundant or maybe there were deaths already, so they were removed from the list already. So that was the that was how the list evolved, Your Honor.
Do we have somebody from the CHR here, Mr. Chair? Do we have a representative from the CHR?
Yes, earlier they were here, but after the interview with the victims earlier, we allowed them to be excused for this particular...
But I just wanted to know lang, Mr. Chair, kasi base sa sinabi ng PDEA, it was around 2020 where, you know, a working draft that was actually validated was finalized, more or less, correct?
Your Honor, just to make a clarification, the file name is dated August 2020, but as early as 2019, the file name is only August 20, 2020, Your Honor, but as early as 2019, because after the NSE,
yes, sir.
General Bitong will explain, Your Honor.
Yes, sir. Actually, starting January 4 of 2016, sir, it already undergo a TWG deliberation. There is no remedy yet. It has not yet been approved.
January 2016?
No, sir. It's January 2017. January 4, 2017.
So meaning, it was on July 1 that the former president assumed office. So it was not until the following year of the first month, January 2017, that this list was, how do you say it, processed, correct?
Sir, may I, actually, sir, starting July 4 of 2016, 5 days after the assumption, the president started showing already and announcing, showing in public the president's list.
So what was the basis of that list?
We only got the official list on January 4 of 2017, the first list.